Hey all, TorqueMoD here. So I've got another tutorial for you guys today. This one's going to be a bit longer than the previous tutorials because it's going to go through several components in order to get to the final result, which is going to look something like this. So essentially what we're doing is we're actually grabbing the player character and moving them into a specific position in order to line up an animation for a true first-person perspective. So you'll see an example of this in the 2016 remake of Doom, where anytime you're interacting with a switch, you'll notice the very subtle blend of the player being pushed into the correct position in order for that animation to play. Now I've exaggerated it in that demo video just to show you, essentially more easily how this actually works, but we'll make it more subtle in our build right now. So here I've just created a new project, and it's using the third person blueprint template. So by default, you'll see it like this. I always just show the sources panel because I find it easier to navigate that way. And I am going to just get started. So we're going to close down my Google Chrome there so I can see my cheat sheet, because I put all this together before the tutorial and it helps me remember what we're doing. So inside the third person BP folder, you're going to find blueprints and then third person character. We're going to open that up. Then I'm going to minimize that. We're also going to, in the content root content folder, we're going to create a new folder and we're going to call this blueprints. And then we're also going to create a new folder and call this meshes, because I've got a custom mesh that everybody can use here. It's a really simple button console mesh, but it's sized correctly for the third person character. So this is going to be, for me anyways, it's going to be in Unreal UE4, and then we've got our console FBX file, so I'll include that link to these files in the description down below. And I've also got a custom push button animation that I made to fit the exact size of this console. So we're going to import that, leave it at the default, choose import. Oops, except, oh, well, hey, why not? It randomly assigned colors to our button. I wasn't planning on that, but that's okay. Sure. And then simple collision. Yeah, that looks fine. I was going to go with a different color, but you know what? The defaults that it chose are perfectly fine. So the next thing we're going to do is in the mannequin folder, we're going to go into animations and we're going to import the custom animation here. And this is animation underscore push underscore console underscore buttoned. We're going to open that up. And then we're going to untick the import mesh. And for the skeleton, we're just going to choose the mannequin skeleton. And we're going to go import. And you'll see that this animation here works fine. So, and the next thing we're going to do is we're going to add an event notify. And we're going to do it at about, let's see. So you're looking at the percentage here. We're going to back up till just before 80%. So 79.97. Then we're going to right click in the notifies. We're going to go add notify, new notify, and we're going to call this button pressed. And we're going to use this later inside of our animation blueprint, but for now that's fine. We're going to choose save. We're going to go back to our third person character. And we are going to, let's see, we're going to actually minimize that, going to edit project settings. We're going to find our input and expand our action mappings there. We're going to add a new action mapping. We're going to call this use. And we're going to use the E key. So we'll scroll down until we find the letter E. And then it's always a good idea to give a secondary mapping for the gamepad. So let's see, gamepad, face button. Thinking of an Xbox controller, so face button left, I believe, would be X. So we'll close that down. And back inside of our third-person character, we're just going to scroll to the bottom here where there's some empty space. I'm going to right-click and type input use, and you'll see our use event. And okay, so next we're going to right-click down here and create a custom event. And we're going to call this check for console. Okay. And we're going to create a variable. And we're going to call this variable near console question mark. And while we're at it, we're going to create another variable. And we're going to call this pressing button question mark. And then we are going to minimize that again. Go back to our blueprints folder. Now we're going to right-click, create a new blueprint class of actor. We're going to call this BP underscore console underscore button. And open that up. We're going to add a component. We're going to add a scene component. Call this root. And as always, drag that up just to get rid of that white sphere, because I hate it. You guys don't have to do that, but I am a little OCD. So from here, we're going to add a component, and we're going to use a static mesh. And we're going to call this console mesh. And for the static mesh, we're going to try button. Oh, what did I call it? Console. Viewport, that is the correct one. And we're also going to add in a, scroll down until we find a box collision. And we're going to call this console trigger. And let me look at my cheat sheet again here. That's what we want. Okay. So we also need to create a billboard. And we're going to call this, oh, and that's actually attached to the console trigger. So we'll drag that back up to the console mesh itself. And we're going to, let's see. Actually, I want the trigger to be a root of, or attached to the root rather than the, rather than the console mesh itself. And so for the billboard here, under the sprite, type in tar, that doesn't work. So we need to, under view options, show engine content. And that should actually allow us to, now type in tar. There we go. And we get target icon. I don't know if there's a difference between either of those. Ah, one's slightly yellow and lower resolution. So we'll use the nice one. And screen size. Let's see, 0.0025. Let's go with 1. Yeah, I didn't think that was going to change anything. So. Ah, that's why. Is screen size scaled correct? Yes. 0.1. There we go. So we're going to have one of those, and then we're going to duplicate it, and we're going to call this button. We're going to actually call this look target location, and I'm going to rename this one to player position. We're not going to worry about where those are right now, because we're going to set the default values in a minute. So now in the construction script, we're going to grab the player position, and we're going to grab the look target location. And so from the player position, we're going to drag out and choose set lock for set relative location. Plug that in there. And for the new location, we're going to use minus 50 in the X and 98 in the Z. And that'll make sense in a little while, but essentially from our player character, the capsule is actually 98 units rather below the Z axis. And now we need to raise it 98 above for it to be in the correct position. And then we're going to just drag out and choose promote to variable. And we're going to call this variable player position. Right, we can't have it be the same name. So we're going to call this player position value. Sure. And maybe I should just rename this guy here F2. We'll call that player position target. And we're gonna look target. Location, yeah, that's fine. Maybe instead of look target location, I gotta call that look target spawn location. That's better. Okay. So, by first entering in the values before we promote that to a variable, it actually sets them as the defaults. So now we're going to do the same thing with our look target location. Actually, no, we don't need to adjust that. We need to adjust the trigger. So console trigger. So we're going to get that, and we're going to set scale. And we're going to choose set relative scale 3D. Punch that in. And the scale we can go for is just 111. And then drag this out, promote to variable, and call this console trigger scale. And this allows us to adjust that to whatever size we want once we place it in the world. And then we're going to do the same thing here, and we're going to type in set lock for set location. And again, we're going to choose set relative location, not the world location. It's very important there. Double click here to just get that line sorted out a little better. And the new location is going to be minus 100, whoops, and 128. And same thing, drag out, promote to variable, and call this console trigger location. And drag that down. And then we're going to click the little eyeball here for all three of those. so we can set them to where we want. Actually, player position, we can leave it. Pretty much, you're not going to want to be adjusting this because we know exactly where we want the player position to be based on our animation. However, if you ever want to make this more dynamic console, so you can swap out the mesh and adjust the position, then you would want that to be instance editable. Editable. Compile and save. Next thing we're going to do is go back to our event graph, and we're going to start to set up the trigger. So let's see, console trigger. So the extent we want actually to be 128 by 128 by 128. Compile and save that. And we're going to right click, add event on begin overlap. And we're going to do a from other actor. We're going to cast to third and get our third person character here. We're going to drag out from here and go set near, and we've got our set near console. I'm going to check that off. So when the player is inside the trigger area, they're going to be near the console. And then back in our, well, compile and save. Oh, what happened? Ah, that can't be found because we didn't compile and save this yet. Compile and save that. Go back here, compile and save that. And then back to our third person character, we're going to add in a reference to our console to use. So we're going to create a new variable and call it console to use. And for the variable type, BP underscore console button, you'll see. So click on that. And then we're going to add another variable, and we're going to call this player look at target, and we're going to set that variable to actor, and compile, save, back to our BP console button. We're then going to drag out from here and choose set console to use. And sorry, we're not going to use. Going to drag that out. Oh no, sorry, that was correct. Console to use is actually going to be right click, and we type in self, and we could choose get a reference to self. Apologies for the sniffing, guys. I've still got a bit of a cold here, or rather, it came back. And then on up here on begin play, we are going to get the look target spawn location, and we're going to get trans for get world transform, and we're going to drag out here and type in spawn actor, and you'll get spawn actor from class. And for the class, we're going to type in target, and we get a target point, and then we'll plug that into the spawn transform. So essentially what this is doing is because our spawn, our look target spawn location is actually, so if I compile and save this, our look target spawn location is actually a an actor component. So the billboard itself isn't a target. We can actually drag this up now. And I probably could actually set that inside the construction script. I didn't before, I had it hard-coded. But so back in the construction script, we actually are going to grab that. And we're going to do the same thing here. So we'll just double that up with the control W, plug it in here. For the target, we're going to plug in our look target spawn location. And then I was using 120, so I'm just going to punch in the Z, 120, and drag out promote to variable and call a look target location. And compile that. Now in our viewport, we should see it there. So because these are actually actor components and not actors themselves, and with our third person character, when we implement, we haven't gotten there yet, but when we implement our player look at target, we're gonna want that actually to be an actor, not an actor component. So the easiest way to handle this is on begin play, we're just gonna actually spawn an actor. And that actor is just going to be another target point, and we're going to spawn it at the exact location of our look target spawn location. So that way, it, instead of being an actor component, it actually is just spawning an actor where our actor component is. And then we're going to plug this, we're going to drag out from here, and we're going to go, all right, we don't have, yes we do, set look. We created it, but we haven't actually linked it to anything, but that's fine. We're going to drag that in here and connect that there. So essentially, when we start playing the game, it's going to spawn a target point, and it's going to set that as our player look at target. So, however, I just realized we probably don't want that to happen on begin play. Because the target might actually change at some point. So we want this to actually happen only when the player hits the trigger. And then we probably only want it to happen once, not every time the player hits the trigger. So do that. Drag out here, type in a delay. Once. Do once. And then drag that over a little bit. Plug that in there. There we go. So that'll only happen the first time the player goes into this trigger. Although. Nope. We do want it to happen every time. Because if he moves to another console, we want to. Okay. That's fine. So we can do that. Spawn actor at location. Just trying to think this out because we don't need it to spawn an actor every time and then destroy it after the fact. Although that's probably easiest. So, okay, from the console trigger, we're going to add an event again, and we're going to use an end overlap. And on end overlap, we're going to, let's drag out here. We're going to promote this to a variable and call this look target. And plug that in there. And that can go in there. And that can go in here. Where is that? Right, that's going to there. Compile, save. And then from here, we're going to get our look target, and we're just going to drag out and type in, if I could spell, destroy. We're going to destroy that actor when we leave the trigger. That should be fine. So that'll take care of that. So every time we walk into the trigger, it'll actually spawn that and set it as the current look target. And when you leave, it'll actually get rid of it in case we set the look target to be something else in the meantime. Good. All right, so the next thing we want to do is, this is actually, as I said, the root of our tutorial here is we're going to set the player's position. So we're going to right click and type in custom event. And we're going to call this move player into position. And from here, to avoid spamming, we are going to do this one on a once, do once. But we're also going to have a reset here. So right click again, custom event. And we're going to call this reset player position. And we're going to plug that into our reset. All right. So then we're going to get player character. And we're going to cast this to our third person character. Plug that in there. And we're also going to get capsule component. So if you go get capsule compo and scroll down to the bottom, that's where you'll find the capsule component. And we're going to right click here and go add timeline and call this timeline underscore player position. We're going to play from start always. And we're going to double click, create a float track, call this alpha, and in a half second, I think. Yeah, maybe we'll do it in a, no, yeah, in a half second. It doesn't need to be. We're going to hold shift and click to add 2 points. The first point is going to be 0 with a value of 0. Second point will be 1 with a value of 1. Sorry, not 1, 0.5. And then click these to fit to screen. We can close that timeline out now. And so we're going to get the capsule component. We're going to drag off. And we're going to type set trans. And you'll see set world transform. So we're going to plug that in to the update. And we are, for our new transform, we're going to get the current world transform. So get trans again, get world transform, and we're going to lerp this. So it's very similar to our previous look at tutorial where we're lerping between two values. And we're going to grab our player position target, and we can just duplicate that get world transform. Okay, I don't need to back up my computer right now. And we're going to plug that into B. So basically, essentially what this is doing is we're starting by getting wherever the player character is, and we're going to blend that to become where our target is, right? So it's actually really simple. Lerps are amazingly versatile for that kind of thing. And then that's going to become our new transform. So over that period of half a second, we're going to blend from this value to that value. And that's going to move our player into position. We don't want to sweep or teleport. In fact, I haven't ever played with sweep, but for now this works, so I'm not going to bother. And let's see. Then when we finish this, we are going to, from here, as our third person character, I'm just going to type in a reroute for a reroute node, because we're going to do a couple of things here. So we're going to drag out and type in set pressing button, and we're going to turn that on just for a second, actually for 0.2 seconds. So we're going to set pressing button, we're going to drag out, type in delay, and then after 0.2, we're going to duplicate that, plug the target back in, and we're going to turn that off now. And that's actually just a way to trigger a state inside of a state machine. So we just need it to turn on and then off again. And that will make sense in a minute when we get there. And then from here, we want to drag out and we want to reset player position. And that just allows the button to be pressable again, because that's our reset player position. Alrighty, so we've got that. We're going to drag out, put a comment around it, and call it set player position. So we've got that there. We're going to use this, or rather drag out marquee select around that, and we're going to call this set. What are we even doing here? Oh, right, we're triggering. So I'm going to call this trigger. Maybe I'll call this console trigger. Because that's all the code for the console trigger. Always misses one of these things here. All right, so we've got our comments there. And what else do we need to do? All right, so back in our third person character, we're going to create an event. Where am I gonna put this? I'll put it above our input action use. So we're gonna right click and custom event. And again, this is a little bit hacky. But we're going to call this control disable and right click again, custom, and control enable. And then we're going to right click, get player controller, move that down, and we're going to disable input on control disable and enable input on control enable. So that way we just have a way of freezing the player. And as I said, the reason I consider this to be hacky is because in this momentary time when we're disabling and waiting to re-enable the input, it means the player can't even pause the game. But they're unlikely to want to be able to pause while halfway through playing the animation for pressing a button. So I think it works well enough. So disable, enable, input. And put that there. Shove this down a little bit. All right, so on input action use, because we only have one thing here, one functionality, we're going to use a direct check for console, but you could put in your own branches depending on certain statements. You would want to check the console or, you know, do something else. Interact with a door or whatever you like. But for now, since we only have one thing that we're doing on use, we're going to check for the console directly. So first thing we want to do is we want to grab our near console. We're going to get that and we're going to create a branch. And if we are near the console, if this is true, then we are going to control disable before we run our player look at target. We don't have that yet, so I'm going to right click down here, custom event, and I'm going to call this player look at target. Oh, what happened? Right, we've already got that. We don't want this player look at target, we just want to call this look at target. And then this is the event player look at target. That works. Compile, save. Then we're going to run our player look at target function. And we are going to say console to use. We're going to get our console to use. And we are going to drag off here, say move player into position. Perfect. And essentially, this is what's allowing us to have multiple consoles in the world. And we know which one we want the player to be moved to by setting our console to use there, which we did in our console trigger here. When we're inside the trigger, we're setting that as the console to use. So, back over here, player look at, can set that up. So under the false, it's a good idea to put a print string in here. The reason being is if anything goes wrong, not near console, you want to be able to pinpoint exactly what is happening. And I like my error messages to be in red and stay on screen for 5 seconds. So, on the off chance that the player hits the input action when they're not inside a trigger, then it's going to return this not near console print string. All right. So from here, we're going to make sure our look at target is actually valid. So is valid the white question mark. That brings back essentially a branch. And is valid is saying, is there actually anything specified as the look at target? So by default, when we compile and save, the look at target is none. So we haven't actually defined a look at target, and so that would actually return not valid, because it doesn't have a valid, it doesn't have a value here, so that makes it invalid. So an is valid check is a way to just save some errors where you might try and do this without having actually specified a look at target, and then you don't want to run the code even though there isn't actually a look at target, because that can create further errors. So our is valid there is just a check. And actually, we're going to do another print string, so I can just duplicate this one. And I'm going to call this look at target invalid. We're going to do that off of the is not valid. From the valid, we're going to right click, add, timeline. We're going to hit the end key there, backspace, and call this player, look at target. And again, we're going to do this play from start. And again, we're going to double click, and we're going to create a float track, call this alpha, give it a length of 1 this time, and shift click to add 2 points. First point, 0, value 0, second point, 1, value 1. And that's just allowing us to, over that second, blend between our A and B values of the lerp, which we are going to add in now. For those of you who have seen the player look at target tutorial, you'll know what we're going to be doing here. But for those who haven't, you're getting it in a double tutorial now. So we're going to right click and we're going to type in get player controller. And from here, we're going to drag out and set rot, set control rotation. We're going to do that off the update. We are going to drag out and get control rotation. Drag out from here, type in lerp. We're going to lerp the rotator. Plug the alpha into the alpha. Tick off shortest path. We're going to duplicate that. We want another lerp. Plug this into the B. And from here, we're going to get the camera. So currently this is actually a third person setup and we don't want that. So we're gonna take our follow camera. We're gonna drag that up onto the mesh. We're gonna delete our camera boom because we no longer need it. We're gonna get rid of the follow in the follow camera because it's no longer a follow camera. And for the parent socket here, we're gonna hit the search and type in head. So that's going to parent the camera to the head bone, but it's also on its previous values from where it was attached to the boom. So we're going to reset that, the location and the rotation by hitting the little yellow arrows there. And then we're going to click the down arrow here and we're going to turn off real time because it makes it harder to actually aim. While it's dancing around, we're going to rotate that 90 degrees, and then we're going to rotate it along the X 90 degrees, so our camera is upright. That'll give us minus 90 and 90, so I'm going to actually reset that, and we're going to punch it in. Minus 90, 0, and 90, because that gives us a better chance of actually getting a hard float value. We don't need a fraction of a percentage there. Again, that might just be me being OCD, but I like whole numbers. And then on the Y, we're going to move that forward 10. And we're going to, down here, we're going to tick off use pawn control rotation, because if we don't do that, then our look at command or function won't actually work. The next thing we're going to do is go into class settings. Class defaults. And we're going to type in yaw, and we're going to check off use controller yaw. So that prevents you from being able to spin 180 degrees and look at yourself from the first person perspective. It's great in third person, but not so good in first. And I hit compile save, and then I realized we were halfway through setting our code here, so that's not working. But it's okay. We can ignore it for now. So we're going to drag out and get our camera. And we are going to get lock. And we're going to, Yeah, we do want get lock. So we're going to get the world location of the camera. And we're also going to get rot. And get world rotation of the camera. And we're going to plug the rotation into there. And we're going to, from here, drag out. And we're going to find look at. And choose find look at rotation. That's going to punch into B. And we're going to get our look target. Look at target. And we're going to drag out and type in get lock again. That's going to give us get actor location, which we're going to punch into the target there. And now we have all of the values we need. Except we want to make sure we punch in, plug in our alpha again. And now when we compile and save, you should see that there are no errors. So we're going to drag around that and go player look at target. Oops. T-A-R-G-E-T. So we're going to set that there. This is marquee around that. Check for console. Move that around. And then around here can be input use. And that might expand later if you decided to add to it. Compile and save. And finally, now we can go back to our animation here. And we're going to want to click on the blueprint. This is going to bring us up to our third-person character blueprint. Sorry, guys. My roommate just came home, so I had to pause for a minute there. Anyways, so the last thing we need to do is inside the anim blueprint here. So when you open up the blueprint tab, you're brought into one of the transition rules for a state machine here. So we're going to jump back to our default state here and drag out from the idle run. And we're going to add a state here, and we're going to call this pushing button. And we're going to drag out and put a transition back into, connect it. We got to connect it to the edge. If you go too far, it doesn't work. So to the edge there. So we're going to now need to create a variable called pushing button question mark. We are going to double click this transition here. And we're going to get pushing button, drag that in there, go back to our default again. We're going to double click in here, go to the asset browser and drag in our animation push console button. And then we're going to go back to the default and our out transition. We're going to right click and go ratio. And we're going to choose time remaining ratio and drag out from here, type in less, choose float less than float, plunk that in there and go 0.2. And that's why we wanted to create our notify just before the 80%, because 0.2 is 80% left, or well, 20% left. So the other is 80%. So what that means is if we had our notify our notify event happening after the 80% completion, it would never trigger. So back here, so that's going to create our state for when we can transition there, and we can test that, compile and save. Here, if we just left click and then left click again, so to immediately toggle it on and off, or rather not. If you immediately toggle it on and off, you'll see that he pushes the button and then he stops. If you leave it checked, he's just going to push the button in a permanent loop and then he's done. So that's working. Now we're going to go back to our event graph here, and from get on owner, we are going to drag out and cast to third person character. And we're going to get pushing, get pressing, I think maybe. Yeah, pressing button. Get pressing button and set that. Alt click and drag out our pushing button. And when the third person character is pressing the button, and we're going to set our value of pushing button. Doesn't matter what you call it, it's fine. If you call them both pressing button, it works. So whenever the third person character's pressing button value is true, we're going to set our pushing button value to also be true, and that's what's going to toggle this. Then we're going to right click here And we can choose our add anim notify event, and we've got our anim notify for button pressed. And what are we doing on the button pressed? Give me a second here. Right, so from the button pressed, we are going to get player character, and we're going to cast to third person character. And as third person character, we're going to enable, nope, not enable input, we're going to, what did we call it? We want to control enable. We want to call our custom event control enable. There we go. So essentially what that's doing is when we, let's go over the whole setup here. So when we hit the use button, we're going to check for the console. If we double click that, brings us over to what we're doing there. We're checking to see if we're near the console. If we are near the console, we're going to disable the controls. We're going to player look at target and move player into position. So player look at target is going to grab our look at target, see if it's a valid look at, so if there's something specified here. If there is, it's going to play our blend for our control rotation. And then we're going to move player into position, and that's from our a command that's embedded inside of our console. So we're going to go over there. And from here, when we walk into the trigger, so here's our trigger. When we walk inside of it, we're going to cast to the third person character. We're going to set the value of yes, we are near the console. We're going to set what our console to use is, which is self, because self being this blueprint. So we're going to say this blueprint in particular is the console to use. Then we are going to set our, we're going to spawn a target point at our look target spawn location. So that's where the look player is going to look to. We're setting that as our look target, which is a variable here. And we're going to set that as the look at target inside of our, inside of our third person character, which is the look at target here. Then we are going to, when we call from the character, when we call move player into position, that's when we get this fun stuff. So that's when we're getting our player character, casting it to the third person, just to make sure it's the right character, where we can grab references to all of our custom variables. We are getting the capsule component. So that's the capsule component here, which is actually the player's collision. And as I said, when you look at the mesh here, it's 97 below the Z. So actually this one here, in our console, the reason we're setting the player position to be a 98 above the ground is so that he's always spawning one unit above whatever your floor is. So that way he's not stuck in the floor. So getting the capsule component, and we're blending it from wherever its current location is to the position of our player position target. And we're doing that over our half second. So we're just quickly bumping the player into the correct position. And then when we've finished moving them into position, that's when we're going to actually trigger the animation. So we move them into position first, then we trigger our animation. Oh my god, lots of updates for my backup software. Anyways, so once we have successfully moved them into position, we're going to trigger our pressing button value inside of our character, which is then going to feed back into our animation here. And anything that we do off of the event update animation. This is essentially the same as an event tick, so that's constantly looking to see if this value is true. So as soon as it detects that it's true, it's going to actually check that off here. And then 0.2 seconds later, it's going to set it to false. So we're literally getting a tick tick. And that way, he plays the animation, but then he stops immediately afterwards, right? So we've got that. And then we're resetting the player position, which is here. We're just re-enabling our do once. So that can't happen multiple times. It can only happen once before it can be reset again. So theoretically, if we just make sure everything here is compiled and saved, compile and save, we should be able to jump into our viewport. Minimize this, drag our console button, put it at the top of the stairs maybe. And let's see, drag it over. And sure, we might as well. Maybe let's make the trigger smaller. So, console trigger scale. We want to scale it along the X a little bit. So, we're going to scale that down. And then I got to move its position. So, instead of minus 100, we're going to make it right about there. Minus 35, sure, doesn't have to be exact. And that way, when the player is close to the button already, it's just going to be a very subtle movement. So actually, let's leave this sorry, the scale there at 1, and we'll do minus 100 for now, just so we can see the difference. So the exaggerated value. So now you can see that we've got our first person. True first person body. We can look down, we can look up, and you see the animations play as you move. So that's great. Then when we get near the button trigger, so it's probably from back here is fine. We're going to hit E. So I'll be looking over this way specifically just to see that our player look at is working. Going to hit E. Oh, and we see that our look at target is invalid. So there's something wrong there. So we got some warnings. Show the message log. So attempted to access missing property none of BP console button. And then set look at target. So our set look at target didn't work. Why didn't that work? Ah. Because we destroyed the actor when we left, but that should have actually recreated it when we enter. Okay, so casting to our third person character, setting whether they're near spawning a target point, setting that as the look at target. Save. I don't know why that's not working. Actually, that should be working. So try again. Target is invalid. Very, very strange. So my initial solution was to set this on begin play. So I'm gonna just try that to make sure that that's all fine and dandy. So we'll cut that out with Control X, paste it over here. So on begin play, we're going to spawn our target point, and then we're actually just gonna plug that in there and the return value here. Because that was working in my initial test. We'll hit play again. Okay. Yeah, there we go. So now everything's working. So, how do we make this more dynamic? Because on event begin play, we're setting that as the look target, but then that means we can't have multiple consoles. which, by the way, is floating in the air. Just select it and hit the end key on your keyboard, and that'll snap it down to the floor. So, how do we make this dynamic so that we can have multiple? Let me think for a minute here. All right, so something went wrong. If we disconnect that from event begin play, we shove that over again. Something went wrong when we actually promoted that to a variable, it seems. So if we just place that in there and we return the value directly into our look at target and compile and save, this is still working. So what we need to do then is get rid of the look target there, and we're just gonna drag these two over here, and let's plug that in as a reference here. And is there a way we can, because we're spawning a target point, is there a way we can set the visibility of that to true when it spawns, just for testing? Set visibility of sprite component. I want to set that to true. Take that off just to see if we can see it spawn in. Yeah, it's not showing it. Because I want to see it be deleted. Propagate to children, try that. So it's actually doing it, but it's very weird. So rather than looking at it from trying to get it visible, let's just see if we put in multiple consoles now. So we'll put one down here. We should still be looking at, so if we walk in here, that's going to set that this first console as the look target. So I'm going to look over there, and when we press E, there we go, it moves and looks in the correct spot. We might actually want to, because our move is happening over half a second and our look is happening over a full second inside our event graph here, we might want to put a delay here of .5 before we fire off the move, so that way when we're looking in the wrong spot, it's up to you whether you want to actually delay that or not. We could I'm gonna see which one I think I like the look of more, but I think I like it better that way. Okay, so there's that first one. Now, when we walk in here, we should look at this console. Yeah, we are. Okay, so it is working. I don't know why setting it as a variable wasn't, but there you have it, guys. I'm not going to worry about why it was acting strange. So this is fully functioning, and that's basically it. So if you like this tutorial, then please be sure to hit the like button. And also, if you haven't already, hit the subscribe button as well for future upcoming tutorials. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you guys next time.